And I know you're very anxious for this next session, and so am I. I'm very honored to introduce our innovation keynote for this year's conference. Over the last 3 years, the impact of social gaming on the industry has been revolutionary, revealing seriously big business opportunities. Our next speaker has spent his career at the forefront of digital and social games and knows this business better than most. Please join me in welcoming the Executive Vice President for Digital Electronic Arts, Mr. Christian Segerstrahl.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Kim. So we heard this morning an electric keynote about the future of marketing by Shingy. I don't know if Shingy is still here. I think I would recognize the hair, if nothing else. But it was really a wonderful, very thought-provoking keynote. I thought about how we really today live in the attention economy, how it's very much about conversations with our players and in our audience across the board, and how our jobs as marketeers are evolving from trying to push people down funnels from awareness to purchase into an ongoing relationship with the consumer where we have a conversation, where we build trust and we build engagement with that consumer over time. So what I'll do over the next 30 minutes or 35 minutes or so is going to be to look at that same future, but through the lens of games. Look at where games are going and what that means for us as marketeers and how we think about tapping into some of those trends and looking into my crystal ball, if you like, as an entrepreneur, what might be some of our success factors moving forward? What are the kind of things we need to do really well as an industry in order for all of us to prosper? But before I start with that, just a couple of quick words about me. I'm actually new to the Bay Area. I moved here just about 6 weeks ago as part of taking on my new position at EA. Before then, I spent 11 years in London as a, call it, digital entertainment entrepreneur, mainly focused on games. I spent 6 years, starting in 2001, spent 6 years building a mobile games company. I founded the European half of what was to be Glu Mobile. My company was called Macrospace. It merged with a company called Sorrent out here to form Glu Mobile. And we went public in 2007 to form one of the biggest mobile games publishers in the world. The dream of setting up that company was to put a game in everyone's pocket. In many ways, and that was, by the way, just before the first phone launched that could do any kind of a download, and way before anybody had even an inkling of what an iPhone might be in the future. But I've really made my career, if you like, from the beginning, and the thing that gets me up in the morning is dreaming about a future state of an industry, dreaming about the future state of consumer experiences, and figuring out how do we make those happen? How can we go from a dream of something that's a potential opportunity and a potential experience to something that's real and you can touch and smell. So I left Glu at the time where we were a public company and a mature business in order to set up Playfish. This was right around the time of Facebook having become big and just around the launch of Facebook platform, where the dream was, is it possible to recreate the kind of emotion that the Nintendo Wii did so well in the living room of transforming game marketing, if you like, from focusing on the explosions and the monsters on the screen to turning the camera around to the emotions between the family and the friends who are playing? Is it possible to do that same thing with online games, which back then were very hardcore focused? Can you create games whose primary function is not to immerse you deeper into a virtual world somewhere, but rather, again, to turn that around and encourage you to socialize with friends? And is it possible to build that in a way which is going to virally distribute itself and ultimately make some money? Don't forget, in 2007, it was very clear and very obvious to everybody that flash games were never going to make any money whatsoever. Now, that turned out to be somewhat wrong. But so we set up Playfish in 2007 in order to change how the world plays games, to create these connected experiences between friends that are social, fundamentally. And so I've spent the next 5 years, if you like, realizing that dream. Two years as an independent company, acquired by Electronic Arts in 2009, and then 2 years as part of EA. Also during that time, I joined the board of a company called Love Film, which is the European equivalent of Netflix, big in the UK, in Germany, and some other UK territories. Really, when they went through this transformation from, again, sending DVDs to people to becoming embedded on the Xbox and PS3 in order to be able to, again, transform a physical media, if you like, into a digitally distributed, digitally consumed experience. And then, I was there really throughout the until it got acquired by Amazon recently, and it now is the Amazon movie solution. And what I did then, at the end of last year, beginning of this year, was take on a new role at EA as the EVP of digital. And what that means for me is my job, if you like, is to figure out how do we as EA ultimately translate what we have today into the future, the next generation of where games are going. We're living in this awesome time of creative destruction. Those of you guys who saw Peter Moore's keynote at this stage or at the other at this conference last year, he talked about the long arc of evolution and Schumpeterian creative destruction of how our industry is going through these, some business models being destroyed and other business models being created. But where content is really at the center of everything and how we as a games industry have a huge opportunity to transcend, if you like, some of the challenges that the music industry has faced in terms of actually monetizing that experience. And where how we as a games industry are actually making tremendous progress in that direction. And so the role that I've taken on at EA is really to help accelerate this transition. We have a wonderful business at EA in terms of some of the most loved brands in the games industry, some of the most global footprints of distribution you could imagine, some of the biggest coverage across devices, right from the Amazon Kindle through to iOS, through to the high-end HD platforms. And we also have enormous momentum in digital. In the last calendar year, we announced that we did more than $1 billion in revenue, which is an awesome number, but I still believe it's very, very much the beginning. So I've made my, if you like, I've worked for the past 11 years on imagining future states and future consumer experiences and then figuring out how to make them happen. So my job at EA is, again, to do very much that. So what I have actually, in terms of the functions that I look after at EA, is all of global consumer marketing, global network engagement, which is the engagement of our communities between our games, global platform product management and analytics and insights. So using those tools, we're figuring out how do we reinvent and reimagine games the way that consumers are going to play them tomorrow. So enough about me. So what I'll talk about next then is the future state, because when you want to dream about the kind of experiences you want to enable and the kind of capabilities that you need to develop, you need to imagine the future state first. So let me talk about the future state a little bit. None of this is rocket science, but it is interesting to put it into context. The games industry is not alone in this transformation that we are seeing right now. In many ways, they are forerunners right now, in that the music industry clearly went through a very long period of transition, but ultimately has emerged with some awesome models for the consumer. If you are a music consumer today, you have more music at your fingertips. You can listen to it more. You have more access from more devices than ever before in the history of music. As an artist, you can get your music in front of more consumers better than any time before. Sure, the business models have changed, but if you think of the consumer experience and the artist experience in the music industry today, it is vastly superior to anything that was possible before. In a similar way, the movie industry has gone from quite a clunky experience to a very streamlined experience with companies like Love Film or Netflix or Hulu, for that matter. And I believe there's a lot of evolution in both of those markets still to come. But very much they moved from being physical products already today to being entirely digital consumption experiences. In games, we haven't quite seen this transformation just yet. We've seen a lot of directional movement in that direction. Certainly, we have a large revenue stream and rapidly growing revenue stream from digital. There also are companies that are focused on mobile, or companies focused on social in particular, that have kind of created ecosystems of their own. But we haven't seen this ubiquitous can play on any device, anywhere type services yet in the industry. And that's, to me, quite interesting. It has to do with the fact that still the most powerful HD experiences in our industry are still very much driven by discs. They're driven by the boxes we have in our living rooms, which take discs as their distribution mechanism. So even though there isn't a one clear winner service out there, if you like, today, there are some attributes to services that we are seeing. We're clearly going from being box products to being digital services. We're clearly going from a model where there's a predominant upfront monetization mechanism where you pay, you get the box, and then you play, to a mechanism where on more and more platforms, actually the upfront component of paying for the game becomes smaller and smaller. If you look at the iOS ecosystem, for example, it has flipped very dramatically over the past 2 years from being entirely paid for upfront to a predominantly free-to-play model out there. In a similar way, we're seeing increasingly channel distribution being augmented and in some cases replaced by direct distribution. whereby our relationship with our consumers becomes more important sometimes than the relationships with some of the channels. If you think of a channel like, or if you think of an ecosystem like Facebook at the moment, there, by far, the vast, vast majority of all installs, of all games, either viral or cross-promoted from inside games. A very small amount is through any kind of curated channel, if you like. On iOS, again, that portion is also increasing. So we're living in a world where these direct-to-consumer relationships are becoming far more important. We're also living in a world where, increasingly, the real emotional reason, the hook, if you like, in more and more games out there, is really to do with the friends, the community you're joining when you're playing, as opposed to that immersive you versus the monster experience, which I grew up with when I played on my Commodore 64. More like me versus the pixel, but I always imagined them as monsters. But those are some of the attributes of what are going on. Of course, this is all taking place not against a static backdrop of hardware, but rather a very rapid evolution in hardware. Where the computer games industry has grown incredibly rapidly to be this, you know, be worth tens of billions of dollars purely off the back of monetizing, if you like, core gamers in the living room. Where up till now, what's fueled the growth of this market, which is today perhaps about 200 million consumers or so, has been just a growth in the device base, if you like, of more and more Xboxes and PlayStations out there. But increasingly now, the growth engine is really not just that, but also the augmentation, if you like, of the gaming experiences through downloadable content, PDLC, microtransactions, and so on. Really, the big game changer of the past couple of years has been this explosion in casual devices and the casual gamers which have joined the industry. If the core gamers are about 200 or 300 million, the casual gamers are well over a billion, if you like, today, who have access to some kind of online gaming or casual gaming device. So we've gone very rapidly from a market of a couple of 100 million gamers, if you like, to perhaps 1.5 billion gamers, perhaps today, and that number is likely to double in the coming 3 to 5 years. So we have a huge opportunity there. We've seen this explosion in the first nascent services on some of these devices, but we haven't very much connected, if you like, these two things together in a big way. The other interesting thing is that devices aren't these days just devices. Devices are actually ecosystems. So when we think of when you partner up today as a game developer, or as a game publisher, you aren't really partnering with a specific device. You aren't just worrying about how do you make your game run on this specific high-end or low-end gaming device. You're actually partnering up with the whole ecosystem, which in many cases consists of high-end gaming devices, casual gaming devices, commerce capability, if you like, catalog and commerce capability, where you can buy more things, you can discover more games, and a social network of sorts. Something which lets you tie into other gamers on that platform. It's got a profound impact because when you're designing games these days, when you look at the ecosystem, you have to think about how do I design it not just for the hardware capability, but for the ecosystem capability of a specific device. How do we make sure that we can plug into the billing? How do we make sure you can plug in the smartest way into the social network capability of those specific devices? And here, clearly, devices, these days, ecosystems, many of them have devices. In fact, whereas the high-end HD console ecosystem is maybe 200 million consumers, today the Apple iOS ecosystem is over 300 million consumers, and obviously the Facebook ecosystem is 800 million plus today and growing, and that's without any kind of hardware. So if you think of these attributes of these ecosystems, in fact, on Facebook, arguably, the most important constraint very early on in the growth of social gaming was the social network itself, figuring out how to encourage sharing, how to encourage invites, how to make sure that people would actually go ahead and somehow create both viral distribution but also viral engagement between users through gifting systems and other things. And I think many of the innovations that we've seen on these casual platforms, if you like, these more mass market platforms, because of the pace of innovation in that industry, many of those innovations have only really started making their way into the living room. Whether it's from a game design perspective, from a social gameplay perspective, from a monetization perspective, and how to think about and how to run that business, and how to talk to consumers. And I think one of the things I'm really excited about the future of the industry is this potential of translating some of those innovations in how we talk to consumers and how we engage our consumers from these mass market devices into the living room. So that's some couple of things about the ecosystems. The interesting thing is that at the same time as this is happening, games themselves have become platforms. If you think of how games are sold on iOS or how they get engaged with on Facebook, increasingly, the a larger share of distribution, and larger share, if you like, comes from either viral or some kind of cross-promotion through these games. So more and more, you start seeing cross-promotion bars inside games. In the case of, say, social and mobile games, they are typically to other social or mobile games, whether where it asks you either to re-engage with another game or it asks you to actually get, you know, install that other game and play that also. Or in the case of interesting Angry Birds, there, the screenshot to the right, it actually asks you even to buy merchandise, sign up to the newsletter, do all those other things. And in fact, these companies that measure themselves in monthly uniques and daily uniques really are very focused on how do you take the whole player base and make them engage with as many products as possible. So if you think about it, we have an explosion in devices. The devices are becoming ecosystems, and the games and brands themselves that we are building on top of all of that are becoming platforms in their own right. So that's a pretty radical transformation of the industry, and it's changing everything, literally everything. It's changing how we design games. It's changing how we think about bringing games to market, because both of those two things become fundamentally affected by the fact that design now has to distribute itself. It's got to monetize. It's got to, you know, invite casual as well as core gamers. And from a distribution perspective, we now need to figure out how do we talk to all these players? How do we get them engaged? How do we get their attention? And how do we keep them engaged throughout our system? And critically, it affects the kind of technology we must have as a company to be able to do all these different things. Because unlike before, where you could have one side of the company make the game and another side of the company distribute it and market it to consumers, suddenly all of these are interconnected experiences entirely, which requires a technology platform at a completely different level in order to be able to accomplish that and deliver those experiences in the future. So that's kind of, in my view, some of the bigger things which are going on out there. So how would we translate this? If you believe that future, if you believe that as an industry we are fundamentally, rapidly approaching becoming a consumer internet industry as opposed to being a fast-moving consumer goods industry, then what are the kind of things that we as marketers need to think about? What are the kind of trends that we should perhaps look at and think about and talk about at conferences like this? I'm going to suggest five, again, as an entrepreneur more than as a marketer, just as observing how we actually generate results from talking to consumers. One, I'm going to talk about the rise of funnels. We heard this morning how funnels are dead and funnels become conversation. I would actually suggest that perhaps funnels in the old world might be dying, but there's actually funnels in the way that I'm talking about them actually very much alive, and in fact probably will become more important as we go forward. Second thing I'll talk about is how digital goes global and what the implications are of becoming a consumer internet market from being a physical goods market. Thirdly, I'll talk a little bit about how marketing goes in-game. Today, marketing is quite a separated discipline from making games. In fact, marketing and making games become intertwined in a sense of designing experiences for consumers, which it hasn't been ever before, so we need to think about that. Also talk a little bit about platform, about technology, and the rise of what's going to be required for all of us to be able to deliver the kind of experiences which are possible in the future. And finally, I'll talk a little bit about science versus art. How science could potentially augment our art and how we're seeing some examples of what we're seeing on that right now. So those five things, real quick. So let me talk about funnels first. Our traditional challenge as marketers and as an industry has been to figure out how do we generate awareness, how do we generate intent to purchase in such a way that our consumers are going to go into shops and ultimately purchase a disc and take it home. And almost at that very moment, when you hear the ringing of the cash register, we would kind of be able to forget about the consumer, because to some degree, we've done our jobs. It's converted, end of funnel, if you like. We've gone from awareness to conversion, and we're done. In consumer, the way that you run a consumer internet company, as I know a lot of you guys have that background also, you really rarely talk about that sort of an environment. You talk about funnels across the board. But unlike a pure acquisition funnel, from awareness through to some kind of acquisition level engagement through to conversion to something to a purchase, actually I like to think of the funnel not as that, but rather as encompassing the whole experience. Because no longer is the event of picking up a game, of distribution, tied to the event of monetization. Over time, as those two things get more and more decoupled, as they have already on iOS, for example, and as they will do increasingly as PDLC and microtransactions gather force also in other platforms, we're going to see a decoupling of those things. And when that happens, you need to think about the business, frankly, much more like a consumer internet business, where acquisition is really just the beginning. If you manage to get people to conversion, that's great, but it really is only the beginning. If you get people actually trying out your product, that's great. But really, engagement becomes much more about how many minutes do you get them to actually play your product? How often do they play? What's the frequency of that? How many days do they play? How do you make sure that when they are done with a specific product experience, how do you then encourage them to try out a different product experience, which might be great for them based on what you know about them? How do you ultimately create deeper and deeper engagement on an emotional level with you, with the consumer? And then finally, how can you create opportunities where for the consumer to be able to purchase something they really value? How can you, in the menu of operating, you know, of operating this game or the group of games, how do you create these moments for consumers where they get something they really genuinely value, get great value for money, they get something they understand for a specific purchase? And then how does that translate into a monetization rate, if you like, as a company? So really a very transformational change in my mind in terms of our jobs as marketers. And there are some, you know, characteristics of that, if you like. If you think about the broader price times quantity becomes engagement times monetization type equation, if you like, and you think of what this funnel really consists of, acquisition and the key metrics, if you like, that go into it will necessarily always be an art form, in the sense that clearly we will always try to inspire consumers. We'll try to come up with campaigns and messages, which, you know, which some of the teams of EA, you know, being a relative newcomer, I'm always, you know, in awe over the kind of the level of creative, the level of, you know, inspiration and sort of those kind of moments with consumers that we're able to generate. That will always be there. But increasingly, when we think about the acquisition process, it becomes more metrics-led, more and more performance-led as a discipline. Because ultimately, what we're trying to do, we are not just trying to drive for conversion, if you like, to a single purchase. We're trying to drive for lifetime value in the process of becoming a consumer across multiple products over a long time period. And in the engagement process, in a similar way, I think we will increasingly, as an industry, begin adopting vocabulary, which is more similar to the pure digital companies and the pure digital type products that you see out there on, say, iOS or on Facebook right now, who express their, you know, themselves in DAU and MAU. I think those are kind of crude metrics still, but it's very much the starting point of beginning to express our success as an industry, less as having sold 10 million units, but rather having engaged. How many consumers have we actually engaged, and how well have we ultimately, how deep is that experience with the consumer? How many minutes do they play? What's the frequency do they play, and so on? And then finally, how well does this overall experience monetize at the end of the day, whether it's through adverts or subscriptions or the upfront price of the game and all of those things combined? And critically, how do we create the sense of value from the consumer, where over time the consumer feels that they've gotten great value for money and hence are willing to be re-engaged in products? So that, to me, is a very fundamental transformation in what we're going to do as marketeers tomorrow. And really, the way, you know, the way that I talk about this inside of EA, and the way we've in fact talked about this a long time, very similar to what Peter Moore in fact talked about last year in his keynote, this is really, this enables us as an industry and as a company to really put the consumer in the center, create universes and kind of consumer paths, if you like, consumer experiences, journeys across our universes of franchises, which ultimately enables us to let the consumer discover things that they didn't know they even wanted. So they might discover things inside of games, they might discover things cross games, where they ultimately, we have an ongoing conversation with the consumer, which is on the one hand a lot of gameplay, but on the other hand a lot of dialogue, a lot of, you know, advice, a lot of help, a lot of ongoing conversation in exchange for their attention. Very much the attention economy from this morning. It's in exchange for their attention, and if we do the right thing and we offer the right opportunities, also their monetization over time. So really, fundamentally about engagement and monetization. So I think that's the first of my megatrends, if you like, out there. Second megatrend that's worth looking at, and what I believe when we're going to look 3 years in the future again, it's going to be important, is digital goes global. Unlike the physical good packaged goods industry, you always have quite a large cost of goods. It's very hard to ship a lot of boxes into areas where there's which are fundamentally more emerging in terms of their purchasing power. On the internet, cost of goods becomes much, much, much lower. And what that means is that really, if you think about the world, not in terms of right now games market shares, but rather in online purchasing power. Again, if you believe that thesis, that as an industry we're becoming more and more akin to a consumer internet industry rather than a packaged goods industry. What does that mean? Well, 2015, online purchasing power. And this is a metric, if you like, of internet penetration times GDP. So it's fairly crude again, but it still gives you a sense. The US in 2015, that's only like 2.5 years from now. The US only represents somewhere between 15 and 20% of online purchasing power in the world. The rest of the world is 80% plus and growing. In fact, some of the fastest growing digital economies today are places like China, Russia, Japan, Brazil, and so on, none of which is usually markets that we associate ourselves as an industry as being particularly focused on. And we at EA have done quite a lot of work, both at my company, if you like, Playfish, and all of EA have done a lot of work to think about this. And we've recently had quite a some successes there. For example, FIFA World Class Soccer in Japan, they launched on the biggest mobile social network in Japan called Gree, which is a multi-billion-dollar business in its own right. Gree, that is, launched in November, quickly became the number one game on the platform. It's still in the top three games out there, as pretty much the only Western publisher offering, and certainly in the top 10, and very much achieved by empowering a local team with a great global brand, which is very recognized and loved locally, but set free to talk to the consumer locally in the local way, where the local social media is critical, set free to implement a creative interpretation of the franchise, which is here actually, as you can tell, it's sort of a card battle game more than a simulation game. And set free to execute on that locally in the way that was appropriate for the market, producing a stellar success for us as a company as a result. So that's a good example of both why brands matter globally and also how approaching global execution, not as in trying to shoehorn a central product everywhere, but rather unleashing the power of the consumers locally, can be a formula for success. In a similar way, we launched the Sims Social on Facebook in the West about 6 months ago, again, climbed to be the number 2 game on the platform and has done very well for us across the board. This is the Sims Social, Mo Ni Shi Wang, which launched on Tencent in China only a couple of days ago. Again, local team, local interpretation of the franchise, local marketing, local conversation with a consumer, reinterpretation of the same franchise in digital. The international opportunity, in my mind, is going to be one of those things which will really shake how we think about our jobs as marketers. Because many of the things we talk about today in conferences like this is successful social media campaigns or successful conversations with consumers, but we talk about all of them in English and predominantly North America. Those conversations, the vast majority of cases, have nothing to do with how this business evolves in China or Japan or Russia or South America or other places, simply because the languages are different, the social media are different, and the tone, if you like, of the social conversation is different. So our job as marketeers to get to those rest of the 80% of the potential actually is something that needs to evolve over time. Third megatrend for me is that marketing goes in-game. I sort of alluded to this earlier, but our jobs as marketeers isn't done anymore when people actually install the game. Really, it's done. It's never done, but it is done when we get a consumer into the game, understanding the game, get them to become loyal and a loyal, if you like, consumer of a specific game or a group of games. And what that means is that more and more of the marketing real estate and how we think about the conversation with the consumer happens in game. So to give you an example, again, Sims Social is a good example, and I'm picking this from social because it's sort of, to me, with a cutting edge in some ways of some of the evolutions of how marketing is operating in the industry is happening. So if you think of a game like Sims Social, at first glance you see a Sims game. But then when you think about the design decisions in this product, first thing is that it's a free-to-play game, so it has to be designed for monetization. It has to be designed with a mindset of retail. How do you make sure that consumers get interesting things in front of them they can choose to buy? How do you make sure you can manage the digital catalog inside the games in a way which is going to fulfill some kind of marketing 101? How do you make sure that there's awareness of the gamers inside of the game of the digital product? How do you make sure that they then convert to purchases of those digital products? We think sort of second-degree marketing almost to the consumers. In some ways, we're all running retail operations inside these little games, or big games for that matter. Second thing is that it's built for live ops. It's built for kind of us being able to add content to it all the time in such a way that those icons on the left when they pop up, you know as a consumer, hey, there's something new here. There's a quest, there's curated play. There's something where, you know, EA has told or given me an opportunity to do something new in this game, which extends the engagement. It's also built for conversation, whereby we can actually, we can encourage our consumers to take part in competitions or take part in ways of discussing something with each other and with us in such a way as to extend the dialogue of the game in, from even inside the game to back out of the game. It's also built for distribution in that, as we heard earlier, influencer marketing is a big deal. It's a huge deal on Facebook, but it's a big deal everywhere. And being able to create experiences which fundamentally encourage our players to go out and shout about what they really love. And it's not about artificial, hey, you know, 10 pop-ups that say share this, share this, share this, share this. But it's, you know, encouraging that those folks who genuinely love the experience to go out there and both get their friends involved, as well as go out and share with the world what they're doing. And it's all game design. You know, none of this can be done outside of actually influencing the game itself. And then finally, building for multiple ecosystems. This notion that very, very, very unlikely that we're going to be in a world in 3 years' time where these ecosystems are entirely separate, where you're going to play different games and different ecosystems and with different mechanics or different things which are entirely unaware of each other. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. But those fundamental design decisions, or what are those hooks that you create between ecosystems, become critical. And they are all, again, it's all about marketing. So fundamentally, when we as marketeers think about, you know, what's the future like, we've got to get in-game. That stuff outside of the game is important, but increasingly the real estate that really will matter is the real estate inside of the games. And it, by the way, isn't just mobile and social today. This is a screenshot of FIFA 12 Ultimate Team, which is all of those principles applied to a game mode in a console game right now. Some super smart work done by EA Sports across the board, which creates massive engagement and a very successful business for the company. So very much happening across all platforms. Yes, not so prominent yet in console, but probably when you think 3 years in the future, probably quite prominent. Fourthly, platform. This is something which is near and dear to my heart. The companies that I've had the privilege of being part of seeing grow, platform has always been central to it. Because it's ultimately what you need to do when you create something new or imagine a new consumer experience is figure out what is the experience you want to enable, and then figure out what do you need to enable that experience. And in the vast majority of cases, you need some form of a platform. And especially if you think of the kind of experiences that we want to enable, that we dream of at EA, of enabling for consumers in the future, of being able to create this sort of a day in the life of, if you like, of a consumer where whether it's across one IP or one brand that you really love, or whether it's across multiple different gaming opportunities, all interconnected at different times on different devices during the day, in order to enable that connective tissue, if you like, those blue lines behind it, they are not an afterthought, if you like. They are the very foundation of creating those experiences. Everything from data infrastructure, all the way to the various, you know, low-level technology hosting layers, all the way to the highest-level tools that enable these games to connect together in such a way as to create truly awesome and inspirational systems for consumers, which ideally are totally transparent. You don't even know it's there. For that to happen, that requires an enormous investment. At EA today, we have over 600 engineers working on platform in order to enable some of these experiences. And it really is about creating some super smart, high-scaling technology behind the scenes, which unleashes the power of creative and unleashes the imaginations of the creators in the company in such a way, and the marketers for that matter, in such a way that we can create these holistic experiences that tie platforms and franchises together. So that's really exciting to me. And then finally, I'll talk a little bit about science augmenting the art. Been a lot of debate about this recently, in particular in the area of the industry where I grew up, in mobile and social, where there's been a lot of companies, you know, saying that they're really analytics companies and not games companies because they track billions and billions of data points every day and they micro-optimize every experience. It's been a really interesting debate to follow across the board because it clearly isn't science versus art in terms of creating entertainment. We are, at the end of the day, an entertainment industry. It clearly is, how do we augment the creative experience? How do we augment that moment that sends shivers down our consumers' spines by understanding them better, by being able to better design, by understanding how they behave, and what they love and how they love it over time. But this science augments the art, in my mind, is we're going to see three different applications of this to us as marketers, again, trying to stay relevant to the folks in this room. The first thing is the rise of real-time testing. As marketers, all of us are very fond of numbers. We're very fond of showing graphs and the impact of various campaigns and things on whether it's, you know, intent or awareness or whatever it might be. My prediction is that when we are in this room in 3 years' time, we're not going to be talking so much about that. We're going to be talking about the real-time testing models of how do we not look back and figure out what happened and hence how do we learn to the future for the future, but rather how do we in real time understand the feedback and modify our approach to the market as a result. Real-time testing is something that's been happening across, say, social and mobile games for some time. This is something that I think is going to creep its way up throughout how we do business, if you like, as an industry. And it can be something as simple as testing the creative of a marketing message, which is happening today, all the way to as complicated as testing the balancing system of a game. Does this feel right? You know, does it? You know, what kind of response do you get from consumers? The second thing that we'll be talking about, I believe, is algorithms and machine learning. Much of our science, if you like, as a business is becoming so complex that there is no way that as humans we can keep up with all the experimentation and the micro-optimization which is going on. So we actually need to figure out how do we plug in algorithms and AIs in order to learn consumer behavior. Because ultimately, again, all of the objective of all of this stuff is to create a better consumer experience, to make sure that when somebody comes into the game, they feel more at home, they feel better about the experience of both discovering the game and actually playing the game. And then finally, the rise of network optimization. As the proportion of game discovery migrates gradually from channel, if you like, to direct to consumer, the importance of understanding the network of games out there and the cross-promotion relationships between them, which consumer owns, what they might want to be playing next across an ecosystem becomes important. And that network optimization is an area of maths, if you like. That's pretty interesting. And that's where it's going to be an interesting marriage of the art, if you like, of segmentation, of figuring out who are the consumer types and what are their needs and wants, with the science of what's the machine learning optimization algorithm for something like network engagement over time. And again, this is something that's very much spearheaded by some of the social companies right now, but it's very much, I believe, going to happen across the whole games industry moving forward. So those are my five, if you like, megatrends. I'm nearly out of time, so let me just conclude with a couple of quick thoughts. And before then, the obvious notion that people talk about lifetime value and LTV a ton. We actually at EA like to think about consumer happiness, lifetime happiness of our consumers in a much broader, bigger way. Because clearly, LTV is a number, but ultimately what we're trying to create is engagement and love for who we are as a company and what we do as a, the kind of products that we create. So LTV is important, if you like, lifetime happiness, even more important. So some future success drivers, and I'll offer you four. One, this mega trend of more consumers everywhere, more gamers internationally, more gamers and more devices. It's going to be a mega trend for some time to come. Figuring out how do we introduce them to great gaming experiences, because at the end of the day, in our hearts, everyone's a gamer of one kind or another. How do we introduce them to great gaming experiences, and how do we let them discover the kind of gamer that they are over time is going to be incredibly important. How do we do that by combining, not thinking of these ecosystems as isolated islands, if you like, of entertainment in different places, but rather being able to offer experiences across ecosystems where literally as a new entrant, if you like, into the market of, hey, I actually discovered, I kind of like this game. How do we offer you the best discovery path of discovering that brand across multiple platforms as well as being able to encourage you to play entirely new kinds of games over time. Thirdly, this notion that we will, as an industry, likely be talking as much about technology and platform in the future from a back-end perspective as we talk about the front-end experiences for consumers. Because it really is that fundamental. These experiences cannot be created without that fundamental enabling technology behind the scenes. And none of that fancy stuff about science augmenting art is possible without having the data infrastructure in order to do it. So another really key component of where this industry is going, I believe. And then finally, on that art versus science debate, it's in the end, and frankly, the reason why I moved my family from London and came out here to work for EA, is because I believe that we're only at the very beginning of the kind of experiences that we as an industry can create for our consumers. And those kind of moments of wonder, when you pick up a device or you pick up, you discover something that does something that you really didn't expect. It rewarded you for your investment with a previous game. It did things. It offers you an experience that you just didn't realize was even possible. those moments as a consumer. I think we're only at the very beginning of being able to create those. And those will be ultimately created by a whole ton of science, clearly, but also by a whole ton of creativity and inspiration. And that's why I ultimately am so excited to be part of the games industry today, which I believe is at the very beginning right now of a truly awesome new era of entertainment experiences, and also why I'm so excited, frankly, to be at Electronic Arts, which I think has so many of the core building blocks, if you like, to build on in order to create some of this new brave new world of computer games. So with that, thank you very much. I think we have time for two questions, maybe, quite possibly. The gentleman there at the back.
In your slide where you showed the various platforms and throughout the day, whether it was in a taxi or at home, you were fully connected. If you think it all the way through and look at the impact these games have had, certainly on our kids and adults a little differently, you talk about happiness and EA and the gamers being happy. Do you think that constant connectivity, being drawn into these products everywhere with your every waking moment, is a positive, a neutral, or a negative?
So that's a loaded question, if there ever was one, on is connectivity a good thing? I think connectivity, whether a good or a bad thing, it's a thing, whether we like it or not. Our, especially young people today, but all of us, we are connected 24/7 through our devices, that we, whatever we do, and it kind of comes back to that attention economy point from this morning. We are connected as consumers, and as consumers are increasingly expecting connected experiences. You are not expecting to lose any information from one device to another. You're not expecting for your email to look different on two different devices. You're not expecting some other experience, your Facebook, to be different in different places. So to some degree, I think connectivity is it's sort of a fact of life, whether you like it or not. What I would say is that it's down to us as creatives to reimagine experiences in the future in a way which is going to be delightful. Again, I think most of the time we've used connectivity to augment an experience that we already understand. You know, we've gone from single player to multiplayer shooters. I think, that's great. But I actually think that we have an opportunity to really truly reimagine the needs and wants of, human beings at the end of the day. Why, so many people play games, ranging from board games to card games to all those other things, for a reason, because there is a great... There's a lot of value to be drawn from using games to connect to other people. And that's why I think connectivity being increasingly used as a medium, not necessarily to, if you like, harass you or to somehow make your experience, interrupt, if you like, your otherwise social experience, but rather to augment it, to keep you better in touch with your friends and family and other people that you care about. So to me, it's what we make of it. It's a fact of life, and it's what we make of it. And certainly, some of the things that we dream about at EA very much has that, at the center. One more question, I think we have time for.
So there was a time when Tencent's virtual currency was worth almost a little bit more than the Chinese currency itself. Do you feel that in the future that, maybe not in America, but other governments might try to do some social control, especially when it comes into monetization, because it affects the government's outlook on things, that governments might try to control the social platforms, especially Tencent, something like that, and especially agree as well.
So it's an interesting question, because clearly these digital economies are growing. I'd say if a government will do as good a job at controlling these economies as they would have done controlling the rest of the world's economy, I think they should stay far, far away from these economies, personally. But that said, I do think that overall, especially I think as a, it's our responsibility as an industry to deliver value to consumers who are purchasing something with virtual currency, and to generate the trust in that currency, and to be able to run that currency, frankly, in a transparent way toward consumers. It's all about delighting the consumer at the end of the day. I don't think that we're at a place today where there's an awfully big role for government in that, but I do think that it's important both through self-regulation of ourselves and making sure that just we hold ourselves responsible for behaving decently, if you like, toward the consumer in these areas. Because at the end of the day, there's still consumers, I think, can still be encouraged to further conduct transactions in virtual economies, and we'll do that by creating, by if you like, by merchandising genuine value and by actually delivering that genuine value and those moments of delight as part of the gameplay experience. So I'm definitely out of time, but thank you guys very much. Appreciate it.